living. Why do I want for things I dare not hope for? What can I hope for? I wish I knew. Draw you near me. Why do I cry? You never hear me. I'm a poor fool, but what can I do? Oh, baby, why was I born to love you?
Max.
What?
Sig and I absolutely loved your show last night. It was fantastic.
What dead show. Men talking. Yeah. Were you there?
Oh, no, the dead men talking. Yes, I was there. Yes. Yeah, I was talking.
By the way, it's a sequel, isn't it? You did, like, since 2007, you did a Henry Lawson one-man show.
It was.
It was.
Yeah.
I did a one-man show playing Henry Lawson.
Yeah.
And it was my first one-man show, really. Yeah. And I realised how difficult I am to work with.
With yourself.
Yeah.
How long did it go for?
What, playing with myself?
No, I mean,
the show, oh, well, I toured it around. Toured it all around Gunning, where I live.
Okay.
Yeah. And
such a wealth of material, though. I mean, how do you nail it down and whittle it down to a concise show? Amazing stuff.
Because I'm so difficult to work with, I had to get an actor who wasn't an actor. So Warren is the perfect person. He's not an actor, but he's a
music producer.
And a full bottle on the history of Australia and Banjo Patterson. So we got him to do Banjo Patterson. And
he's an authority. You've known him for a very long time. Are you guys close friends?
I haven't known him for a long time.
Yeah?
But we did an old people talking to other old people session.
Okay.
That they do with people.
Geezer segment.
A geezer segment.
Yes. It was a live act.
Thank you. Soft drinks.
Yeah.
I have a coffee.
Have a soft drink.
Thank you very much. Yes. What did I do? Oh, where was I?
Faye.
We were a double act, just talking to the elderly persons.
Yep.
And I sang a song, and he knows every song that's ever been written in Australia. But I sang what I said was the first ever Australian folk song.
Yeah.
And he said, I haven't ever heard that.
Yeah.
And he said, it's not the first ever, so it's from an Irish song and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. And when I was going to get a banjo, I thought he'd be the ideal banjo. Because he'd never worked with actors before, so he wouldn't know that I'm difficult. He wouldn't know that I ad-lib, and he ad-libs as well.
That's cool.
We sort of make it up as we go along.
So, with every show that you guys perform, there's a little bit of different performance
every time. There is, yeah.
That's cool.
So, for example, last night in Deadman Talking, which is a fantastic play with a two-hander between two of you, was there a lot of ad-libbing on that, or was it based rough scripting and you sort of throw the banter, and it was just hilarious too.
Yeah.
Of course, some of the main works from Banjo Patterson and Henry Lawson. You play Henry Lawson, and Warren plays banjo. And he's so good on a squeeze box too.
Oh yeah,
very good.
And because we have an audience that are frequently familiar with Henry Lawson and Banjo Patterson, if we say a line wrongly, we'll get a prompt from the audience. And that's always going to help. And if I do dry, I can ask someone in the audience, what's my next line? And I would get the proper response.
And there was a lot of comedy in the show
which
I really enjoyed.
It's supposed to be a drama, man.
Yeah.
Well, you didn't laugh, did you?
I did. There were quite a few great comical moments in there.
I was saying to Warren last night, though, I'm a foreigner, and you may have noticed, and it was good to see the real quintessential Australian, the outback, the bush, and the identity. It just really came through strongly. You guys nailed it.
Yeah,
by the way, you signed this last night. Thank you so much for that. I was wondering if you could sign this for my mum. She's a really big fan of yours.
Oh.
I didn't get it from close up.
There you go. Yeah. Look at that.
Beautiful.
See that?
Speaking of moderate amounts of inebriation, You played Henry Lawson last night as a real, how can you say this in Australian, pisspot. Was he that much of a serious alcoholic? And you were reveling in the role and sort of.
Yeah, there was a lot of research.
Oh yeah.
And
I suspect he could not metabolize alcohol too well. Yeah. He was anorexic most of the time.
Really? Oh.
And he was probably bipolar.
He died in the 1920s.
1922,
yeah.
Yes.
22, yeah.
And
what was the cause of his death?
He stopped breathing.
That would do it.
Yeah, I think so.
And apparently he was found in a chair, and the housekeeper or the woman looking after him wasn't sure he would. He was just sitting there gazing out the window, as he did a lot. She came closer to him, she saw a fly crawl out of his mouth. He'd been dead for some time. A fly got away.
So Max, tell us about this new film, Broke. We've been meaning to watch it.
We can't see it
in Melbourne though, because for some reason it's only being shown at the moment in New South Wales, Western Australia and Queensland.
I think that's because it's about football. And I don't think you play football here in Victoria.
Yeah, no, we don't at all. It's just a
gambling addict or something.
75% of all the teams are here.
It's aerial ping pong, I think, is what you're called here. Yeah, and this play is about it's about gambling. It's a gambling addiction, and it's about a footballer who's no longer playing football. So what does he do? Because he hasn't had much of an education. He's a bit of a lost soul.
Now, what do you do when you get the urge to gamble?
I gamble.
Yeah, what would you do if you could do something else?
Everyone was saying BK was in on the fix, right? Everyone's saying that. I'm like, no, BK's a stand-up guy. He wouldn't do a thing like that.
Hey, get in.
I got no place to go, mate.
Hello, stranger. It's been a while.
He was our local hero. The whole town was behind him when he was on top, and now they just turned their back on him, and it's not fair.
In the end, all he'll do is break your heart, mate. I don't know what you see in him.
You reckon you could just kind of try to train him like a normal person?
No.
Hey! Hey! Oh, come on! Hey!
All they know is footy. We eat them up and we spit them out.
Once a scumbag, always a scumbag, Kelly.
You shut your mouth or I'll knock your block off.
Oh, come on, Pops, have a crack.
It is a Steve Lamarckand.
Yeah, he's fantastic.
Yeah, he's a great actor. I loved him in Last Train to Frio.
Oh,
if you remember
fantastic.
That one?
On the train, yeah.
I think they got a very good cast, with no money. It was made for us. The guy's got his daughter, and she's a. They're just huge fans of this particular footballer.
Yeah, he's a local hero.
Yeah, and this.
He breaks into your house one night.
This guy's son died of an overdose in prison.
Yep.
And was a big fan of a big fan of the Lamarckand character as well.
Mm-hmm. I'll ask you. Do you know when we're getting it down here in Melbourne, bud?
No, I don't.
Wow, look at this.
There's your heart starters.
Thank you very much.
Is that a Bloody Mary?
No,
oyster
these
shooters.
These are to bathe my eyes.
Yes.
Someone's already bathed their eyes.
Thanks very much, Ruth.
Thank you.
Lovely, we will.
Yeah, so what drew you to the project of Broke? Because it looks like it's been getting these rave reviews, and apparently it's just a fantastic drama.
It is.
By a director who's only on his second film.
Get out.
It's only his second feature-length film, which is quite impressive.
He went to America and had a bit of experience over there, and he's written a terrific script.
Yep.
And Steve Lamarckand rang me and said that we've got no money for this film. It's crowd-funded, small budget.
A lot of films are now. It's very popular to get a film crowdfunded.
Yeah. He said in his usual form that the script is shit, but we can make up our own dialogue.
Yeah.
and so that's pretty much what we did.
Yeah.
With the director's blessing.
Yeah. Any chance of it coming to Melbourne anytime soon?
No way. of course it'll be.
Yeah, it'll happen.
It'll be here for some festival. I don't know, for some reason.
It's winning awards already.
Yeah. It's won quite a few. Max, you've worked with an enormous amount of some of Australia's greatest actors and directors. You work with Hugh Jackman and...
Yeah, Australia.
Yeah, of Leonardo Wolverine. DiCaprio. You were in The Great Gatsby and...
Gatsby.
Jack Thompson and Julia Blake and Judy Davis and... Oh, man, off the top of my head, there's just so many.
Yeah, I meant to ask you, do you ever get stopped in the street? And it must happen all the time. You say, hey, you're that guy.
Hey,
you're that guy.
Hi. Welcome again.
Oh, here we are. How are we going?
Welcome, Max.
Thank you.
Lovely. Oh,
boy.
Thank you very much.
Thanks so much for that.
Oh, what's fantastic. Okay.
You know what? I'm just going to get my usual.
You have chili?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Big Texas beef and bean chili. Yes. Thanking you. That'll do me very nicely.
What am I going to have?
The hot dog's really good.
How about a hot dog? Do you have any hot dogs?
Should we go for that?
There's a Huey dog.
Huey dog.
Huey.
And I'll throw in some fries.
Fries around.
Brilliant. Thanks so much for that.
Pleasure.
So do you ever get stopped in the street and they say, hey, you're that guy.
All the time.
Can he come over here? It's Jack Thompson.
No. Usually it's George Clooney.
George Clooney.
Yeah, or Brad Pitt. I get that one a lot.
at the risk of being offensive, Max, George Clooney?
Are you being offensive?
At the risk of being offensive.
Oh, well, we've got all our similarities.
You know, you've come across to me, having watched many, many of your films, you're kind of like a mix between Orson Welles, and Dennis Hopper. You've got that vibe about you.
Yeah.
You play a lot of quirky characters.
Yeah. I met Dennis Hopper.
Yeah, you did.
And his uncle. I worked with his uncle.
Oh, wow. Was that when he was here doing Mad Dog Morgan?
No. Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Dennis is...
Hopper.
Hopper.
Yeah. He was a bit of an artist as
uncle,
well.
His uncle was in a Orson Welles film.
Yeah.
And he was in... Gunsmoke.
Gunsmoke?
Oh, wow. What do we got here? The Dow?
Hey, look at that.
The Dow?
Looks delicious. Thank you.
Yes, Gunsmoke.
Oh, it's the
chips.
What's his name? Dennis. Dennis. Gunsmoke. Limp.
Dennis Weaver.
Yeah.
Yep.
I loved him in Spielberg's Duel. That was a great film.
That was stunning.
Well, they made that in their spare time because there was no money.
Yeah. Oh, there was no money at all.
Pretty well only the two of them.
Exactly, and a truck driver.
Oh,
yeah. Well, they discussed at length the arm that was going to come out of the truck.
Yep.
So I said, why does it have to be it must have been tricky to decide.
Could we just grab a napkin and
it was a very
spoon?
Hitchcockian thriller, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And a spoon?
You want everything.
Yeah,
what sort of a spoon?
Big spoon, yeah.
So heavy. Oh,
thank you very much, sir. Voila. And the ketchup.
And not on crème, monsieur tout, le bechien de l'on,
nice.
Won't be long, Fred.
Thank you. We have tomato sauce in Australia.
Tomato sauce?
Yeah.
Where's the ketchup?
Is it called ketchup?
Ketchup, correct.
Yeah. The food is really good here.
Oh, yeah.
Where are we?
Big Huey's Diner.
Big Huey's Diner.
I know Huey. I've seen Huey on TV.
Hmm.
You like a little bit of food with the tomato sauce, do you?
Oh, yeah. Just a little bit.
And so, Orson Welles, I wagged school when I was a kid to see The Third Man.
Oh, wow.
Oh, one of the greatest films,
and I came home and I could remember every scene of that film. Mm. It was because I was so young. It stayed with me. I think because I wagged school, that was part of the...
Touch of Evil was my favourite.
Oh, yeah. Well, Dennis Weaver was in that.
Yes, he was. Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's exactly right.
That was stunning.
Yeah.
He was the strange man working in the motel.
Strange man.
That's incredible.
So yeah, I mean, with a lot of your earlier roles, particularly, you played a lot of quirky characters.
Yeah.
Which is quite interesting.
I started off on stage playing all sorts of characters. A lot of old blokes. Mm-hmm. At 23, I was playing an 83-year-old.
Oh really? In what role?
But you like playing people, apparently, that are totally different than what you are. Just really out of.
Yeah, I'd like to think so.
But
there's no hiding. You know, it's always your character that comes across. Mm-hmm. If I play someone particularly evil, there's a reference of my childhood, a school bully, mm-hmm. and I can just bring him up.
Yep.
And he's just somebody just I just see as being such a sadistic, horrible, dreadful person. Or a buffoon. I'm very good at playing buffoons. Because a lot of things that I take so seriously that it's funny.
I loved your role in Summerfield, 1977.
Oh, yeah.
Nick Tate comes to your house because he needs a room. And he goes into the room, the very same room that the missing teacher occupied before he disappeared.
Yeah.
And you play the husband of that promiscuous, curvy, busty beauty who's just so, you're so weird. You're like, it's like you've been suspecting your wife of sleeping with all these men for so long.
Yeah.
And you've kind of just retracted into a life of misery or denial.
Gee,
I love that character. It was so...
And all I was thinking of, I hope we're not having the same thing for lunch. That's method acting, you see. It's not what you do, it's what you think that comes across.
Orson Welles said, ask not what you can do for your country, ask what's for lunch.
But I mean, in the script to that film, though, was your character instructed to be the jealous husband?
I decided that I would be a suspect. Mm-hmm. So I thought everybody in the film should have been a suspect.
Yeah.
What the film reminded me of? The Wicker Man.
Oh, sure.
Oh, yeah. Kane.
No, the director was the same guy who directed Sunday Too Far Away.
Mm-hmm.
And he'd been in England doing a whole lot of stuff.
That was a great movie.
Yeah.
It was a great
place to work with him on that
Sunday film. Too Far Away, that's another film which really resonates with me because... In many ways, it's quite similar to Wake in Fright, where where you've got these Aussies in the middle of nowhere, and they're unable to escape their reality because they're constantly spending their money, and they're kind of stuck in a vicious cycle.
Yeah.
They can't get out because they keep splurging all their money, and they keep spending their money because they're bored.
Yeah.
No. And it's just such a beautiful film. I love your acting. I love the scene early on in the film where you're kind of giving a guy a hard time because he's challenged Jack Thompson, claiming that he's not the best shearer in the land.
I'm no gun shearer, and I got a better tally than Johnny and Aaron McDowell's that year. The only fast thing about Johnny is his mouth. Foley'd have a sheep shorn before Johnny could remove the fuzz from his own arsehole.
I got to ask, though, I mean, was it difficult, really difficult, having to eat Jack Thompson's rissoles?
I love it.
John Hewitt.
That must have been tough.
That actor who played the cook, who came, the first cook, was hilarious.
Yeah. He was very good. But he, to get into character, he drank a flagon of sweet sherry. So... there's a lot of Jack holding him up in that scene where they're having a fight.
I was wondering to myself during the movie, why didn't you guys gang up on him and beat him up?
Oh, because he was too tough.
One-man army.
Yeah, and he could poison us so easily.
He was big.
Yeah, he was big.
You know, I've never had lemon essence. What exactly is it?
It's very alcoholic.
It's high in alcohol, is it?
Yeah.
Okay.
But you mentioned... Wake in Fright.
Yeah.
I auditioned for that.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
What a classic film.
And
Jack Thompson was in both.
He was indeed. And the director really wanted to use me, but there wasn't a part suitable. And then at the end of the shoot, there was a character who, his line was, "You're mad, you bastard. Come and have a beer."
Yeah.
And there was wind across the microphone. And that particular, because he cast people off the street.
Yep.
He just liked the look of people and he cast them and he said we can dub them later.
Really?
Yeah. So that particular actor, not just bloke off the street, from the money he got on the film, he bought himself a truck and drove it very quickly and hit a tree and killed himself, so he wasn't available to do the voiceover, to do the dubbing. So I put a cigarette box, a box of matches in my mouth and held my nose and copied his voice.
There you go.
The director said Max can do all the voices on this film.
Yeah.
So I was there for a fortnight, chain smoking, and dubbing people. And one actor, after he'd seen the film, etc., he said, they dubbed me. I said, they didn't, did they? He said, yes. It's not right. Not right. And I said, no, mate, it's good. Because it really looks like you can do an Australian accent. And he said, oh, yeah, right, huh? And
it was, got the appearance.
It was like another year later, he said, you bastard. It was you, wasn't it?
Yeah.
You dubbed me.
But
You cannot tell a lie.
I cannot.
By the way, in Midnight Spares, I think that came out in 1983, a cameraman died in the production. Yeah. What happened there? Did a car smash into him?
I was waiting to go in. It might have been my last day. Mm-hmm. And the stunt guy, his name is Max. He was sitting in his car, the engine running, at the gate. Mm-hmm. And they said, you're coming in? He said, no, I can't. He said, there's something wrong. I just feel there's something wrong.
Are you serious?
Yeah, and he backed out and went away.
Yeah.
And a car just lost control and hit the focus puller, was killed.
Was that in one of the scenes in the racetrack, or one of the ones on the road?
It was on the track.
Yeah.
It was going to be so easy, but it was also very easy for someone to be in the wrong place.
There's another scene in that movie which I'm fascinated by. I got to ask you about it. You're being questioned by these guys, and you get dunked into your head underwater in the sink.
Yeah.
Did you have to hold your breath a bit for that?
I did. I deliberately held my breath for a long time.
I
was thinking, I'm going to hold my breath until they tell me to cut, and I won't be able to hear them cut.
Oh, exactly,
to
underwater.
And get me. So I would have been under there for a minute and a bit.
I loved your accent in the film as well.
Yeah.
Oh,
it was what was it, a Polish accent or a Italian?
Czechoslovakian.
Yeah, Czechoslovakian.
Yeah, and I had a hearing aid, and I had a limp.
Yeah.
And I turned up in character for the for the part, and the director said, oh, yeah, oh, I didn't have to say anything. I just had the role. He said, but no. And then he turned to one of the assistants, and he said, no, well, there's a scene where Max gets angry.
Yeah.
So he will have the makeup girl standing by to put some red makeup on his face. So, and I said, and I grabbed the director, and I bounced him on the wall, and I said, I don't go red when I go angry, I go white. I really knew I really had the part then.
But in Midnight Spares and also Running on Empty, you play mechanics. You know a little bit about cars, or that a big
I know absolutely nothing about cars.
No, he wasn't a mechanic. He was like a blind enthusiast.
Yeah, but I was able to fix cars.
Yeah.
And this is possible.
Yeah.
There are blind people who just listen to the car and know that when there's something wrong with it. And I went to the Royal Blind Society and spent a day there and learned how to be a blind person. Mm. And I was being led by a blind person who kept running me into things.
Hey, Ruth. Oh, this is so delicious.
Oh, yes.
Thank you so much.
Here we go.
Very nice.
Thank you. You look, I got to say, you look cool in those black glasses. Really nice.
That's a sweet noise you got there, man. I had you picked clear across the valley.
You got a nice machine yourself. Want a race?
It's got a real following, that film. Mm,
it does, yeah. Mm. Followed on Mad Max, I think, in those days.
Yeah.
It had an American Graffiti vibe to it.
Mm.
I like that.
Beautiful looking film.
It's a very iconic Australian film.
Yeah.
It's considered one of the best kind of red-haired...
Mm.
Films of its generation.
Yeah, we've been trying to get a sequel off the ground, but for some reason, it's difficult. It's not happening.
They don't find out.
You know, Quentin Tarantino absolutely loves Midnight Spares and Running on Empty.
Get out of it.
He's really into exploitation films.
Oh, yeah. Mm. Ah. That's right. Well, the director said it was an exploitation film. The producers were saying it was an exploitation film. I couldn't see that.
It kind of was, you know, chicks, cars.
Yeah, but I thought this...
More exploitation.
Yeah, exploitation.
I could just see how it would... It was about challenge and competition. And no matter how fast you go, there's always going to be someone faster. Mm. But there's no end to competition.
Absolutely.
Just no end to it.
It continues, the cycle.
Yeah.
I want the whole fairy tale, the old fairy tale. You can temper with investments or a well-furnished nail. Tax-exempt or charge accounts and Tiffany's bells. A attitude to gratitude to Tiffany Express. No sale. I want the whole fairy tale.
I want the old nursery rhymes. Happy endings, valentines. You can cover me with roses from my head to my toes. Smother me with compliments, couturier clothes. But anything that's offering that doesn't propose will fail. I want the whole fairy tale.
Hometown,
white gown,
dearest family and friends.
When you say
I do, then if the rings from Cartier,
it wouldn't open me.